Hello, everyone. Now, I know that it's hard to keep up on top of what's going on in the Holy Land, but if you want to know more about what's happening here in Israel, I'm Aaron Porras, and this is the Weekly Review.
Israel's lockdown is set to end tomorrow morning at 7 a.m. That is, if the government doesn't decide to extend it. Even as Israel aggressively vaccinates its population, experts worry about what could happen without any restrictions at all. Most are fed up, and many aren't listening to the rules anyway. Still, the country needs a plan, and fast. Hannah Rifkin reports.
Another delay for Israel's coronavirus cabinet in deciding whether or not to extend the country's lockdown. So far, disagreements have ruled out any firm decision.
לא, אנחנו לא מצליחים לכנס. סוכם בישיבת הממשלה האחרונה, שאכן נשב אתמול, כדי לדון בתוכנית היציאה המדורגת לציבור, כדי שהציבור ידע זמן מספיק מראש מה הולך לקרות. וראש הממשלה הודיע בדקה ה-90 שהוא הלך לאיזושהי פגישת קמפיין בחירות, וכך קיבלנו את זה.
Israel is well on its way to vaccinating the entire general population over 16, with 38% who already got the first dose.
רואים כאן שאנחנו במספרים מצוינים של יותר משלושה מיליון איש שכבר קיבלו את המנה הראשונה, מתוכם 1,382,000 אלף הם אנשים שכבר זכאי תעודת מתחסן.
The health ministry announcing this week that everyone is eligible to get the shot, extending outreach to anyone above the age of 16. Clinics around the country were left empty after large portions of communities had already been inoculated.
יש כבר יותר תנועה מאשר קודם. אני יכול לומר שבחצי שעה האחרונה היו פה קרוב ל-50 אנשים. ובעצם מאז שעות הבוקר, מאז שהמתחם הזה נפתח בשעה 8 בבוקר, היו פה קרוב ל-200 מתחסנים.
Meanwhile, Israel and Greece are reportedly negotiating a tourism pact to mutually recognize the country's vaccination certificates, this allowing Israelis to travel. Although, there is no word yet on when Ben-Gurion Airport will reopen. Also, according to a new report, the number of babies under 2 years old who were diagnosed with COVID-19 in January nearly quadrupled over the previous month, with almost 6,000 new cases in infants. Here are the latest numbers. On Wednesday, the health ministry recorded 7,397 new cases, with a positive infection rate of 8.9%. There are 1,120 Israelis in serious condition, with 331 on ventilators. The death toll stands at 4,975. Hannah Rifkin, ILTV.
Meantime, as Israel ramps up its vaccine campaign, so too is the Palestinian Authority with Israel's help. With around 32% of Israelis receiving at least one of the two-dose coronavirus vaccine, Israel is now rolling out thousands of doses to Ramallah. Jerusalem on Tuesday already sending 2,000 of the 5,000 pledged Moderna vaccines for Palestinian healthcare workers. Palestinian Health Minister Mai Al-Kaila crediting Israel for the donations.
هذا لقاح ولقاح موديرنا الأمريكي حصلنا عليه تبرع من إسرائيل وهذا اللقاح يعني يعتبر آمنا حسب مواصفات منظمة الصحة العالمية غدا أو بعد غد سيصلنا لقاح الروسي وسنستكمل من باللقاح الروسي هذه الكامبين.
Okay, moving on now. And anti-aircraft missiles were fired at an Israeli drone flying over South Lebanon on Wednesday, but did not hit their target. Lebanese security sources say Hezbollah fired at the drone, but the missile did not hit the aircraft, which then returned across the border. The IDF says anti-aircraft fire was detected from Lebanese territory during routine operations, adding that the UAV was not hit and continued its mission. Nearby locals reported hearing the sound of an explosion. And just hours later, another escalation in the north. Syrian television reporting late on Wednesday that the country's air defense mechanisms responded to Israeli airstrikes allegedly targeting Hezbollah operations in the country. Reports described the attacks as happening in Quneitra province in southern Syria, close to the Golan Heights. Okay, Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu canceled his planned trip to the United Arab Emirates and Bahrain for next week, of course, because of the pandemic. A prime minister's office statement said Netanyahu was doing so despite the importance of the trip. This is the third time Netanyahu has postponed a trip to the UAE due to coronavirus-related restrictions and political developments in Israel. The prime minister announcing just 2 days ago that the original trip, which was supposed to be 3 days, had been shortened to just hours.
את הביקור בדובאי דחינו פעמיים בגלל סגרים. יש לו חשיבות ביטחונית ולאומית ובינלאומית גדולה, אבל צמצמתי אותו לבקשתי משלושה ימים לשלוש שעות. שלוש שעות, זכה, זה לא ביקור בדובאי. זה באבו דאבי. לא יהיה ביקור בדובאי. זה באבו דאבי, ייתכן גם ביקור בזק בבחריין, שתי מדינות שקרתו איתנו בריתות שלום, ואנחנו, יש לנו הרבה מה לדבר איתם, כולל אפילו בנושאים שקשורים בקורונה, אבל כפי שאתם יודעים, גם נושאים חשובים רבים אחרים.
In other news, Israeli authorities are criticizing the United States for leaving Jerusalem impossibly stuck between a rock and a hard place with respect to Iran. Israeli military officials likewise preparing to act where they expect Washington will not. Chan Rifkin reporting.
Government minister and close ally to the Prime Minister Tzachi Hanegbi on Tuesday describing a harsh reality, stating that the U.S. will never attack Iran's nuclear program, meaning Israel must decide to strike alone or come to terms with a nuclear-armed Iran. And Defense Minister Benny Gantz adding that Israel's defense establishments are holding on to the option of taking action against Iran if that's what has to be done. IDF Chief Aviv Kochavi likewise ordering the military to develop operational plans for striking Iran's nuclear program. This coming as the U.S. warns that Iran is potentially just months away or less from nuclear breakpoint. Then doubling down on its mission to nuclear breakthrough, Iran announcing plans to install 1,000 new centrifuges at Natanz, Iran's main nuclear enrichment plant. The UN's International Atomic Energy Agency, meanwhile, confirming that Iran is enriching uranium in its underground Natanz plant. As Irani envoy to the IAEA, tweeting that there's more to come soon, with both Natanz and Fordo ramping up capacity. As for how the Biden administration will respond, U.S. State Department spokesperson Ned Price is leaving things open.
I mentioned a couple of them, consulting with our allies, consulting with our partners, consulting with Congress before we're reaching the point where we're going to engage directly with the Iranians and willing to entertain any sort of proposal, especially since we've been very clear about what the proposition we have put on the table. Yeah.
But in spite of such promises, Israel fears that the U.S. will rejoin the 2015 nuclear deal, with the Biden administration repeatedly saying it's willing to rejoin if Iran first returns to compliance. The IAEA making clear in March of last year that Iran is in violation of literally every tenet in the agreement.
IDF soldiers foiled a knife attack this morning at a West Bank checkpoint. Security forces say the terrorist approached troops stationed at the Gush Etzion junction near Bethlehem and was neutralized after attempting to attack a soldier with three blades attached to the end of a wooden stick. The attacker later succumbed to his wounds, and the IDF are continuing to investigate the incident.
Now, as for peace talks that have worked, Morocco and Israel now opening relations like never before after normalizing ties late last year. And Foreign Minister Gabi Ashkenazi is speaking with his Moroccan counterpart Nasser Bourita for the first time Tuesday evening. Ashkenazi describing the historic meeting as, quote, warm and friendly. And finally, working swiftly to implement agreements, the two countries plan on establishing embassies and inaugurating direct flights within the two countries within the next 2 months.
Israel and India celebrated nearly three decades of relations last week. And as they marked the milestone, a bomb went off just outside the Israeli embassy in New Delhi. While no one was injured in the attack, officials say it was terror-related.
An explosion occurred near Israel's embassy in India on Friday. There were no casualties in the incident and no damage was caused to the embassy building. But the timing was interesting. It was the 29th anniversary of India-Israel relations.
Call yahi thi ki bomb blast hua hai, wahan pahunchi. Acha to
koi nuksan hua hai kya koi?
Nuksan ka hame nahi pata, shishe teen gaadiyon ke shishe toote hain, bas humne number le rakhe hain.
To aapke paas blast ki call thi,
blast ki call.
According to Indian media, a terror organization called Jaish-ul-Hind, believed to be affiliated with Iran, has taken responsibility for Friday's attack. Israel's ambassador to India, Ron Malka, had said earlier that the country had strong assumptions that the blast was a terror attack. Indian police say the explosion was caused by an improvised explosive device, or IED, and the impact from the blast could be felt within a 20 to 25 meter radius. The attack is still under investigation.
कलेक्ट करे हैं हमने सब आईओ को हैंड ओवर कर दिए हैं एक्सप्लोशन था अभी क्या एक्सप्लोशन था ये लेबोरेटरी में एग्जामिनेशन के बाद केमिकल एग्जामिनेशन के बाद ही हम लोग बता पाएंगे
Meanwhile, India's foreign minister says he assured his Israeli counterpart Gabi Ashkenazi of the fullest protection for the embassy and Israeli diplomats. Chana Rifkin, ILTV.
Now, speaking of security cooperation, Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu praising his Indian counterpart Narendra Modi on Monday for safeguarding Israeli officials in the wake of the bombing last week in New Delhi, an attack just outside the Israeli embassy, which Jerusalem is now treating as an act of terror. A statement from Netanyahu's office detailing how Modi responded, noting his country's commitment to security and continued cooperation with Israel in fighting terror. But that said, Indian police are still looking into the culprit or culprits behind last Friday's explosion, saying the low-intensity IED was likely a mischievous attempt at creating a sensation.
Explosion, examination, chemical examination.
Well, the investigation is ongoing, still gathering all the pieces and the evidence that we get from the scene and pieces of information from all over. There is a full collaboration between the Indian authorities and the Israeli authorities. And as of now, our assumption, strong assumption, that it is a terror attack.
And as for naming a suspect, so far primary leads are still hinging on a handwritten note found at the scene in which the previously unknown Indian Hezbollah claims responsibility. Meanwhile, partnerships with Israel expanding now to Kosovo as Israeli Foreign Minister Gabi Ashkenazi accepts the European country's request to open an embassy in Jerusalem, and this making Kosovo the first Muslim-majority country to do so. Ashkenazi therefore presenting a plaque at the virtual ceremony, which will be placed at the embassy's entrance.
The establishment of a relationship between Kosovo and Israel is yet another important, exciting, and historic step. This morning I received your formal request, Madam Minister, to open your embassy in Jerusalem, which of course I approve, and I look forward to seeing it open very soon, hopefully with you.
And also attending the ceremony, which marks the first time two nations have remotely established diplomatic ties, was Kosovar Prime Minister Hoti and U.S. State Department Representative Matthew Palmer, who hailed the warm ties between the two nations as a long time coming, a sentiment likewise shared by Kosovo's foreign minister at the meet.
Kosovo has waited for a very long time to establish diplomatic relations with Israel. On this important day, we mark a new chapter in the historical bond between our countries, who have witnessed a long and challenging path to existing as a people and to becoming states.
Kosovo and Israel first announced the intention to establish ties back in September at a summit at the White House. Serbia, which also pledged at the summit to move its embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem, has yet to act on that promise. All right, now in other news, as Kosovo becomes the latest in a series of Arab or Muslim states to normalize ties with Israel, some of the architects of these deals are now having a moment of their own in the sun.
Former White House senior advisor Jared Kushner, his deputy Avi Berkowitz, former U.S. ambassador to Israel David Friedman, and former Israeli ambassador to the U.S. Ron Dermer are all now the latest nominees for the annual Nobel Peace Prize. And this in addition to the earlier nomination of former President Trump himself, all for their respective roles in negotiating the landmark Abraham Accords, arguably the crowning achievement of the Donald Trump presidency, with the United Arab Emirates, Bahrain, Sudan, and Morocco signing on in just 4 months' time. The Abraham Peace Accords with Israel marked a massive and continuing shift in power and alliances across the Middle East and beyond. Especially now, with Kosovo being among the many countries to follow suit, as promised. Unlike President Trump, however, Kushner, Berkowitz, Friedman, and Dermer's nomination comes through the hands of legal expert and Harvard Law School professor emeritus Alan Dershowitz. And Dershowitz explains that these accords, which have brought about normalization between Israel and several Sunni Arab nations, fulfill all criteria for the prize, and are in fact the singular event that warrants the award for 2020. But of course, there is some strong competition, including Russian dissident Alexei Navalny, the World Health Organization, climate change activist Greta Thunberg, and the Black Lives Matter movement. The Nobel Prize Foundation is expected to announce the winners in October 2021.
Israel isn't worried about the U.S. reevaluating a weapons sale to the UAE. Since the beginning of Joe Biden's term in the White House, he has put on hold a sale by the U.S. of advanced F-35 fighter jets to Abu Dhabi. Donald Trump approved the sale in order to move forward with signing the Abraham Accords, with some Israeli officials saying it would threaten Israel's qualitative military edge, but later accepted that this was part of the agreement with the UAE. Netanyahu brushed off Biden's reevaluation, saying ties with the UAE are business as usual and will continue to be.
וכולם מבינים שיש פה יתרונות עצומים. זה שלום תמורת שלום, זה שלום תמורת סגסוג, זה שלום תמורת קדמה, זה שלום תמורת טכנולוגיה, זה שלום תמורת עתיד. אני לא רואה את זה. אני חושב שזה ילך קדימה.
Meanwhile, business continues to boom between Jerusalem and Abu Dhabi. The UAE reporting that in just 5 months since the signing of normalization, trade has reached more than $270 million.
Now, massive protests are erupting late Tuesday night across four Arab-majority cities in Israel following the killing of two in a police shootout earlier this week. It begins Monday night, where police engaged with armed suspects at a house in the city of Tamra, killing one suspect and wounding another. But in the crossfire, police also reportedly killed a university student and wounded a doctor. Demonstrators in Tamra on Tuesday then responding with a state of mourning and a strike, continuing later in the evening to set car tires on fire and block main roads. Similar protests, meanwhile, popping up in the cities of Tira, Umm al-Fahim, and Nazareth, where, along with several members of Knesset, protesters chanted slogans against government and police, specifically over the supposed lack of enforcement regarding the increasing violence and crime in Arab-Israeli communities. Ironically, though, the initial Tamra shootout followed just hours after a string of overnight and morning raids, including in the city of Tamra, and Israeli police arrested dozens of suspects suspected of shootings, burglaries, arson, drug and weapons trafficking, and much, much more. This is part of upholding the government's latest plan to do better for the Arab sector. Now, elsewhere in Israel, in the northern city of Nahariya, citizens are all on the lookout for a very unusual new predator, jackals. The Galilee Medical Center now having admitted at least 9 people in just the past 48 hours arriving with bites from these feral canines. And it's not just happening while out jogging in the woods or anything. Recordings of several recent attacks showing jackals approaching and attacking unprovoked, sparking growing fears in the Nature and Parks Authority of an outbreak of rabies. Other experts, on the other hand, are blaming improper waste management, leading to a surplus of food and therefore a boon in the jackal population. But the Nahariya municipality claims that it is in full compliance with disposal guidelines. So whatever the reason, maybe keep a stick of beef jerky or something handy as a potential diversion for escape. And swinging back now to coronavirus for a moment, lockdowns seriously weighing heavy on us all, including apparently on zoo animals. Caregivers from Jerusalem reporting some surprisingly sad faces as the biblical zoo's population experiences its newfound and extended alone time. It's quiet in the Jerusalem Zoo, too quiet. And apparently even for the animals, because as much as we love to peer through the fences at our favorite exotic creatures, it turns out that they may enjoy the reverse just as much.
We are here with the chimpanzees, the great apes, and we see that the last months they are really seeking for interaction. They are sitting above, they are playing with each other. We are trying to do enrichments, but they are missing the visitors in the front big window. And we saw it before, that they are really keep coming closer to the window, they are playing with the people, they are interacting, and now they are really missing it. They are sitting and waiting that the zoo will be open again.
And of course, it's not just the chimps who are withdrawing from the lack of attention.
This is the black and gold howler monkeys. And you see here, we have one male and two females, and we do see change in the behavior when there are visitors and we don't have the visitors. For example, you came here, the zoo is closed, but you are a group, and we see that they are back to the upper area of the exhibit. They move out from the house, and they come back to interact with the visitors. I'm happy to see it.
But as with all rules, there is an exception, and the sole outliers seeming to be the lions, who have found some confidence and comfort now that the large and noisy crowds have been away.
We do see they change the behavior with using different location in the exhibit. At the beginning, we saw they are more behind and using the other area. Now we see that they're coming closer to the pass, closer to the keepers. They feel more secure when they see less people.
All right, in other news, the focus on clean and green technology is still going strong in Israel, and it's now being highlighted in the exciting Sustain IL 2021 startup competition, the online contest aiming at finding solutions to environmental challenges and celebrating Israeli companies that lead in the trend. And the event is hosted this year by Startup Nation Central, an independent nonprofit that connects Israeli entrepreneurs to world leaders, NGOs, businesses, and more. But of the more than 100 applicants to Sustain IL, just 6 were chosen to compete as finalists against a panel of judges. And of the 6, waste conversion startup companies UBQ and Clarion took home the top prizes for mature stage track and early stage track innovations, respectively. Still, never shy of challenges, remaining Israeli entrepreneurs continue to reinvent themselves using their knowledge to impact the world for the better. Israel ranking 6th overall in the Global Clean Tech Innovation Index. Results from a recently published research paper may soon pave the way for landmark treatments against various brain diseases. Imagine a technology giving a detailed Google map of the location of genes inside the brain. Well, thanks to an Israeli-led research team, such a technology is on the verge of occurring. Teams from Bar-Ilan University, Harvard, and MIT detailing how they analyzed the hippocampus of the brain without destroying any tissues. Or put another way, while doctors have for years struggled to analyze RNA or ribonucleic acid from brain tissue, now they can do so at the nanoscale resolution level. And this is likely leading to breakthroughs in the fight against Alzheimer's and other similar illnesses. Research author Dr. Shachar Alon saying that it's the equivalent of having a vast and detailed Google map of the location of genes inside the brain and other tissues, rather than a low-resolution image or a simple list of the genes that are there. And that's it for ILTV's weekly review. I'm Aaron Porras. See you next week.